to order. Good morning, everyone. Glad to see everyone here. And we have one item on our agenda today, which is our presentation from Director Newborn for our Human Resources 2023 budget. So welcome, Director.
Thank you so much. Great to see you all in person. It's been a while. I was sharing earlier that it's probably been 2019 since my last budget. Well, I don't think I did the budget presentation in 2019, but the last time I was here before the chamber. So thank you so much for having me.
Director Newborn, I'm so sorry. Would you move just a titch to your right? Yep. And if media services could turn up the mics a little bit. It's a little bit hard to hear with the mask, and I just want to make sure.
Yeah.
There we go.
That's better. I'm going to move.
You're all good right there. And
I feel like I'm screaming.
Nope.
But I know that that's usually not the case. So is this okay?
You're good. Yep.
Great.
Thank you.
Well, thanks for having me. I'm going to jump into the presentation here. Feel free to ask questions throughout. Lots of information that we want to share, and really talking about starting out with the state of the city of St. Paul, so big C, and then talking about the state of our city, the city enterprise. And then we're going to move into HR strategic plan, the priorities that we have in human resources. We'll talk about our workforce strategy around hiring, recruitment, and retention. That's like the buzzword for now, especially across a lot of jurisdictions and a lot of employers, but in particular for the public sector and for the city. And then we'll talk, you know, at the end there's like one or two slides about our actual budget and the proposed cuts that the mayor has made. And again, feel free to ask questions throughout. So moving into the labor market, the state of the city. Now, we're not going to go into a lot of detail about, you know, the labor market in general. That is not my expertise, right? But there are some obvious things that we know. The labor market has changed since post-COVID, another buzzword that folks have been using. Our employees, our potential candidates, our residents, they have an advantage. They are making decisions about where they want to work, how they want to work, when they want to work, and how much they want to get paid. So this is this is what we're facing right now. When we're doing our hiring, when we are talking about retaining folks, when we're trying to recruit folks into the city, this is what people are thinking about just because of the changing labor market and the changing environment. Our unemployment statewide is relatively low, and we know that there's differences between our people of color and women as it relates to unemployment, but overall, unemployment is relatively low in the state. Our residents, our community members are saying, hey, I want flexible schedules. I want to work remote. I want more money. Folks are quietly leaving their employers to go somewhere else or to take a sabbatical. I know all of these things that you all know, but I just want to ground us in the fact, like, these are the realities that we're dealing with. We talked about employment, we talked about the market, that our employees have an advantage, and our employees are seeking beyond just like the money piece and flexibility. They want purpose. Like, why am I working here? What's the mission of this organization? And am I going to be happy in this particular organization? These, amongst many, are the questions that our residents, our community members, our employees in the city are asking themselves right now. And so when we move into kind of the state of our city of St. Paul as an enterprise, what are we facing? Our workforce is a little shy of 3,000 employees, and that's full-time employees. We know our Parks Department brings in a lot of temporary and seasonal employees throughout the year. That takes us up to about 4,000 and some change. But roughly, for our full-time employee workforce, we're a little shy of 3,000 employees. 50%, and this is an obvious statement, and Tara over here from OFS can correct me if I'm wrong, but a little over 50% of our budget, general fund budget, is salaries. So it's people. That's what our general fund goes towards, is our staff and our people. Our racial equity demographics that we have continued to increase. I started with the city in 2015, which I can't believe, so it's been 7 years, and I've moved across many different positions, but now back in HR. When I started, our racial diversity numbers for the city was at 19%, roughly. We're now just under 30% people of color. And that's amazing. It's amazing and great work. But we know that the city of St. Paul, Big C, is now a BIPOC majority city. So over 51% of our residents are people of color. So we still have a long ways to get to a place where our workforce mirrors the people that we serve. But we've made some headway. Our women workforce has continued to hold around 30%. It ebbs and flows and goes through peaks throughout the years and over the last few years that we've been really tracking this. But we remain steady at 30%. Post-COVID, right, what has happened? All things have happened during this time. And it's hard to say post-COVID because COVID still exists, but we are coming out of sort of the pandemic and the state of emergency. What has happened? It's becoming hard to fill positions based off of the things that I told you about with the labor market, right? People are taking their time to make choices about where they want to work. They're asking for more. They're asking for the flexibility. There are some hard to fill positions, and that's happening citywide, but we're seeing our accounting positions, our positions that require a commercial driver's license. Just as an example, some of our parks positions, we've had some difficulty filling. And especially those seasonal workers and temp workers throughout the year. But we're seeing that largely citywide. But there are some special positions that we're seeing, we're just having more difficulty than others. Again, our employees are saying, or potential employees are saying, I want more flexibility, I want higher wages. There's been some safety concerns, right? Our employees not feeling supported in some of our public-facing departments and public-facing spaces. And so there's some safety concerns that we've had that we need to address. And then it's essential for us to, given all of this, we need to change how we recruit. And, you know, recruitment is one component of this work. Retention is also as important, or maybe even more so important. Once we bring people into this enterprise, what are we offering them? How do we keep them? How are they growing? How are they feeling supported? But also having a recruitment strategy, one that's different than what we've done pre-COVID, is important and essential. Vacancies and hiring. I know that that's been a question that this body has asked of multiple departments and have asked of us as well. Our vacancies are not, from what we're tracking, now vacancies is like a snapshot of time, right? So if I look at our vacancy numbers today versus 2 weeks from now, it could significantly change. So it's hard to like track it. But when we've taken that sort of snapshot of time, we have about 197 open recs in the system. Now, open requisitions may mean a lot of things, but there's an open position, roughly. And there's an open position in the city, depending on what stage it's in and the process and the hiring process, that position could be filled tomorrow. That position could be delayed for another couple of weeks. It really depends on the departments and our partnership with HR, so with HR as well. So right now we have roughly about 197. That's a relatively low number, but there are certain of those positions that we know, depending on the type of position and the market, that we're gonna have a harder time filling. So they may be open for a lot longer. We're seeing that we're having to repost positions, certain positions, not all, but we're having to repost, and that extends the timeline. So, yes, council member.
Sorry, it's easier when you're not chairing the meeting to raise your hand and not necessarily interrupt someone mid-sentence. So really sure where to cut in there, but thank you. I'm curious, if 197 is not a high number, what is a typical average number of open requisitions that we see in the city? And to your point about how long those positions have been open, I think we've been doing a good job with our department directors trying to parse between vacancies versus long-standing vacancy, like a vacancy that's been longer than a year.
Sure.
So can you give us a sense of how many vacancies we're talking about that are longer than a year, that are significant vacancies?
I don't have that information in front of me now, but we can definitely follow up and grab that. What we're seeing, and I'm just going to refer to some of my notes because I knew that this was a question that we were going, that was going to be asked about with the vacancies. We're having to repost, as I mentioned before, on some of our positions, so that's going to extend. So our postings, our hiring process is usually about three months. Now that's on a good day, right? 3 months it'll take from start to finish when a requisition is open to when an offer is made and that potential candidate then turns into employee and starts. It takes about 3 months. What we're finding, and when we post, our posting period is roughly about 20 days. But for some of those positions, as I mentioned before, like accounting, our CDL positions in public works, water, and even parks, maybe not libraries, but those three departments, and maybe even in OFS with fleet. When we have those, post those positions, we have to extend the posting by sometimes another 20 days. Now now we're getting into 40 days over a month of posting and trying to recruit and hire for a position. And then it takes about another month or possibly 2 months given the interview time for us to actually bring someone in. So it doesn't quite answer your question directly. I do want to take some time to come back with that data and information, but what I'm trying to lay out is the timeline of why, if there are positions that are longer than that 3 month period that are open, it's because of some of the labor market challenges that we have. And we've had to, my team in HR is having to work to then repost, figure out our recruitment plan with the departments, and then try to get some candidates. And what we've seen, you know, specifically and also anecdotally, what I'm hearing is that we're getting, it's low application numbers. So for some of these positions, not everyone, but not all of them, but for some, for some positions, we may get 5 applicants. Well, that's hard. And I think, you know, this body has experienced that as well with some of your positions here. 5 applications, that's a low number, and it's hard to make a decision about who the right candidate is to bring into your spot. So then we have to go back and then try to repost and re-strategize and extend. So there are some of those positions where we're seeing that. What we're not seeing is that, you know, significantly, I should say, we're not seeing positions being on vacant for an entire year. And what I will say, council member, is that the position in itself, sometimes our departments decide not to fill the position with a certified, classified employee that's certified into the city. But if they're having problems filling the position, they're definitely hiring some temps. They're definitely hiring at a provisional level. So the work is getting done. It may not be because of various reasons that they've been able to hire a full-time certified employee. Does that make sense?
It does. And for the first part of the question, just about the normal number of open requisitions, do you have a sense of that?
Sure, yeah. Let me just take a moment to look at some of the data to see if we capture that.
You can follow up if it's not handy. Just trying to, 200 open requisitions seems like a big number, but I know in context it's not. So I'm just trying to figure out like what's normal.
No, so just to compare, so we have 197 open requisitions, which I said, half of those are with the departments and the other half need some sort of job posting or need to go through the civil service examination process. 202 job postings to date. In 2019, around the same time, the number was 227. And we do HR does about 20 postings a month. And so I do want to, I'm still not getting directly to your question. I do want to follow up with that information, but I did want to provide, like, here's what we've been doing. We're seeing some dips in kind of low numbers around job postings and around our applications and applicants and those numbers. But I do want to follow up with to answer your question specifically. Let me make sure that I covered everything. So we talked about vacancies. It's a higher demand. So, you know, I have a team of total 41 people in HR. On the hiring team, it's roughly about 13 individuals, and not all of them are doing hiring. So we have about 6 or 7 folks who are focused on hiring for the city. Now, if we did all of our comparisons about like how many people that you actually need for a city size of that has 3,000 employees, we're under for that. And so I'm sharing that not to advocate for, you know, anything additional from what we were talking about here, but just to say, trying to, with the number of people that I have and the demand that has gone up significantly from our departments for hiring, We're under the gun. We are stretched, would be the nice word to say in that. But we are seeing definitely a higher demand for job postings. And my team has been able, as I mentioned before, you know, about 20 job postings a month. That's a lot. That's a lot of work that happens with that. So that just gives an overview of the state of our city and what we're dealing with and how we're trying to respond to the ever-changing demands. This slide, I'm not gonna spend a lot of time here. It just goes back to what I said earlier around the percentage of our general fund budget that is for people, for our employees. So roughly about a little over 50% of the general fund goes towards salaries.
Ms. Bernack.
Council members, Director Newborn, I just wanted to provide some context to that. The 50% is for the total budget. It's closer to 80% in our operating funds, specifically in the general fund. So when you look at the 50% number, that includes capital and debt service, so for the total budget. So appreciate the opportunity to provide that clarification.
Thank you so much, Tara. And the experts should definitely be in the room to provide context around that, so I appreciate it.
And actually, while we're clarifying, thank you, Ms. Bernack, going back to the previous slide, Dr. Newborn, I'm sorry if I missed this, but the very first bullet point, citywide total workforce counts have remained consistent throughout the years. Are you saying that percentage-wise or consistent in a number sense? Because I know I believe our workforce has grown year over year.
It has. We've seen almost a jump between, if we look at last year's number of employees to this year, it's about 150 employees we've increased by 150 employees. But roughly, if we look at over 4 or 5 years, it's gone up some years, down some years. So I think that's what we're talking about. It is remained consistent. But we have seen some growth in the number of employees.
Okay. So we've grown or we've remained consistent? I guess I'm just...
We've grown.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. Thank you.
So over this past year, so I started as the HR director in 2020, August of 2020. So it's been now going on over 2 years. And we've started to work, when I started in that position, we started to work on our a strategic plan. We haven't had a, you know, one that we've been able to communicate to the city leadership and to the council about what is HR doing, where are we going, how are we getting there? So we've spent this past year working on a 3-year strategic or operational plan. What we have come up with in our operational plan is 4 strategic directives. One including foster an inclusive workplace culture. The second, amplify the growth and experience of our city employees, foster and build relationships across departments, and improve overall operations to create more effective and efficient services. And I want to focus on, all of these are definitely important, but what we're seeing and what I'm seeing in this position at this vantage point is the need for, we have a lot of rules, we have a lot of policies, we have a lot of practices and procedures that have been in place for a long time. And good or bad, right or wrong, the question that I am constantly asking is, who are these rules for? And if they were created 50 years ago, we know that the city of St. Paul was not a BIPOC majority city, and nor was the city workforce. Women weren't in the workforce, women weren't in leadership positions, nor were our BIPOC community. So it's time for some change and modernization, and it's time to figure out, can we stop doing things? And do them faster in a way that is going to support our staff, going to support our employees and our residents in the services that we provide. So we're putting a lot of energy and time and thought and planning into making those changes as a part of our strategic plan. Our priorities in HR, we spend a lot of time thus far talking about hiring, recruitment, and retention. That is a priority for us. Competitive and comparable salaries and benefits. Now, this gets into wage, this gets into negotiations, which we're in negotiation season right now. But you know, it used to be where we talked about for the city of St. Paul. Well, the city of St. Paul has great benefits, and we do. We have amazing benefits, but our salaries are not as competitive. Now, we get into the space of the private sector does this. We can't compare ourselves to the private sector because we're not. We're not the private sector. We're not making money. We're not churning widgets to create a profit. Our work looks different, and so we can't compare ourselves to the private sector, but we can compare ourselves to the other members of our public sector community. And still, all of us, Hennepin County, Ramsey County, City of Minneapolis, are struggling to have those competitive salaries. And we're all having the same conversations and questions about what do we do? How do we change our negotiation strategy? How do we find the funds to be able to pay our employees more? We are prioritizing to re-energize our city employee safety committee. This is really important. I know this body has heard from employees and heard from staff and department directors around the need to ensure that our employees are feeling safe. And so we've started and re-energized our citywide employee safety committee, which I'm really excited about. We also have spent some time and energy in working with the consultant on redesigning our human resources support. And I say that not just the department, but we also have what we call HR liaisons. We have a decentralized HR system, and where we have HR professionals across our departments. It's time for another reason for us to modernize that work and to ensure that we're best supporting our department. So it's time for us to think about how do we redesign HR so that we, for onboarding, for promotions, for keeping folks, for recruitment, we have a better structure to support our residents, we have a better structure to support our employees. We've lifted up learning, training, and development as well. We, 2 years ago, or maybe a year ago now, we hired our Deputy Director of HR, Abigail Gadea, to focus on training and development in HR, and we put some really great resources and framework into that work. So we'll talk a little bit later about the work that she's been doing. And then payroll. When we talk a lot about hiring, but when we bring people into the city, we have to pay them, right? And so our payroll department is instrumental in ensuring that that happens. So as the demand increases for hiring and bringing more employees, that 143 employees that we've seen increase that we've seen over this past year, our payroll department also needs to be supported. And so you'll see later on in this presentation that the mayor has, in his proposed budget, has given proposed for HR to have an increase in one payroll person. But it's time also for us to look at those efficiencies and services that we're providing and doing some process improvement in that space. And then lastly, I have over the last, this administration, the last 4 years have served as the chief equity officer. And I'll talk in more detail about this, but we are now, to make this work sustainable, we will be putting that work into HR and creating a division of equity and inclusion. And I will sunset the role as me serving as the chief equity officer, creating this position and title and hiring someone to serve in that role and them working in HR. But we'll spend some more time talking about the plans for that. But these are our priorities here in HR. So what's new? I'm not gonna go through all of these because it's a lot of information. Hopefully you have time to review. But what's new in HR for this year? Creation of the Civil Service Rules Work Group. This is something I'm really excited about that I don't think a lot of people are excited about that actually knows about this. This is the work that's not flashy. We're not gonna have a newspaper article written about this, but I'm super excited about it because it gets to the systemic work that needs to be changed in order for us to have the flexibility and be competitive and an employer of choice for the city of St. Paul. These rules have been in existence for over 50 years. John Dillinger and Al Capone, these rules were created because we had organized crime in our city, right? To my knowledge, we don't have that anymore in the way that it was presented and operated that many years ago. So we don't need those rules in the same way that were originally written. And so we're doing some work in HR. It's not an overhaul, it's an amendment. It's modernizing these roles so that the end result of our hiring process, how we promote, our examination process, will benefit all of our city employees and all of our residents, not just some. And when I'm talking about that, this is one of our strategies around dismantling systemic racism in the city. So who do these rules benefit largely? White males. And we have said 30% of our workforce are people of color, 30% of our workforce are women. The rules in themselves and these systems that we have in place need to benefit those communities and those demographics. So we're spending a lot of time in that space, and I'm really excited about it. We also are partnering with OTC, within the enterprise fund to upgrade our Enforce system and TAS. This also is a heavy lift, but super important. We could talk all day about how this, we can't pull this data, and this is manual, and we don't have this, and we can't do that. My hope is that we do this rollout really well, so that when you ask me a question about turnover or attrition rate or X data, I can say, here you go, I'm gonna pull this out, and here's the data that we have and that is supported. So I'm really excited about that. Training, learning, and development work. We provided over 15 workshops to all city staff. It's amazing. Our deputy director has done a great job of building out a training and development framework, and we're continuing to do that. We haven't arrived, but we're continuing to do that, and I'm really excited, and we're getting great feedback from our employees about, hey, we've been missing this. We're glad that the city is investing in training. We've also had... I've talked about the HR restructure work and that we're moving that forward. I've talked about our strategic plan, the creation of the equity division. We had to create a title and a position for that role because it does not exist. And actually, within the next couple of weeks or month, you will have that position before you so that we can create the title and then start the hiring process, which could potentially take place before the end of the year. So that position, the manager position, will report up to me. We already have an equity and inclusion specialist position, so we're really expanding HR to embed the equity work, not only in HR, but across the city. And what's really important to me, and I know that is important to our mayor, is that this work outlasts this administration. Right now, the chief equity officer position and title is tied to the mayor. So when the new mayor comes in, then that work could be gone. This, and I feel really strongly about the fact, I used to be in a place where the equity work needs to be separate from a department, right? And that the chief equity officer should be working with the department citywide to make sure that the work gets done and that we are investing in it. What I learned is that the human resources department, and this is not me lifting up my department in a way from an ego standpoint, but the human resources department is the nucleus of the organization. Everything that comes in, your whole experience as an employee starts with, in some shape or form, with HR. So who else, you know, better suited to embed the work around equity, racial equity, diversity, and inclusion than the human resources department? So it doesn't work for every, that strategy and platform doesn't work for every organization, but I think it's really, it has been working and will work for the city. And then lastly, as we continue to build out that division in HR, we're working on data, looking at data and creating a dashboard that where we can pull from and set goals around racial equity, gender equity, et cetera.
I think before we move on, yes, from the slide, is there a list of all of the trainings that are available to city staff? And do we have an equal focus on developing managers as they proceed through their careers? I know we do a lot of work on the front end with new employees and orientation, that kind of thing. And I've seen a lot of equity and allyship trainings, which are wonderful to see. I haven't seen as much how to manage, how to help, yep, you know, performance improvement plans, things like that. And I know that I hear from staff that, you know, that want to be able to grow and want to be well managed, but this seems like a gap for us. But maybe I'd love to see sort of what the bulk of our trainings are so I can understand if that is being provided, and I just don't know.
Sure. I can have the deputy director provide you with that list. In response to your question that you asked about Supervisors Academy or Supervisors Training, there is a gap. And the deputy director and I are working on building out what was formerly known as Supervisors Academy. We used to have that. What we found is that it was good at that time. People wanted more. We needed to embed conflict resolution. We needed to embed, you know, how do you communicate in a way that's seen as coaching and ensure that is a regular conversation, ongoing conversation that we have with staff. Performance management, performance reviews, there's a gap in how we do that. Every department does something differently with that. There's some opportunities there. So we are working on building out that training. There's a couple of trainings that we have coming up that's just for leaders, and specifically at the director level. This tomorrow, we're actually going to be undergoing a training with Mimua, a former state senator, I believe. And she's going to be leading us through the directors through a training tomorrow, a workshop. And it's mostly focused on, from a leadership standpoint, embedding racial equity, communicating, leading our employees, leading a diverse group of employees. So we're starting to turn the dial in that space, but there definitely is opportunities for us to build out a more strategic plan for building our workforce out from a supervisory standpoint. So thank you for that question. So I spent a lot of time on this because I knew that this question was coming up, right? And so here's that slide. I pretty much have said everything here, but again, creating the new title, sunsetting the equity, chief equity officer position, and me holding that role. What I didn't add is, and I've shared this with the mayor, the next HR director that this city hires, and this is not me making any announcement, but the next
don't. We don't need that 197 to tick up.
No. But the next HR director needs to have an eye for equity and inclusion and needs to be a champion of that work. And so hence why, again, really passionate about building out that role, building out the work in HR, and rebranding HR to include equity and inclusion. So sometime next year, the name of HR will change. I don't know what it will be, but I can guarantee you we'll have something in there around equity and inclusion. And again, setting us up to sustain this work and embed it into the city. But I believe on this slide I've covered most of what we're doing and how we're doing it.
So, Director Newburn, before we move on, you did mention this, but I just want to be clear. So, hire new equity and inclusion specialist and hire an equity and inclusion manager. So there would be two positions in the equity division?
Yes.
And do we already have, you said we already have one of those?
Yes, we do. Great question, council member. We have an equity and inclusion specialist position. It's a slightly new title than what we were using before, but we've had the FTE in our budget for the last 2 years for that role. And I'm in the process of filling that position. We had a vacancy from over the summer, and I'm in the process of filling that position, so within the next couple of weeks. The new position will be the manager position. That is the position that we needed to create. We're taking the FTE, so to speak, or the funding for the chief equity officer position and transferring that into HR to fund that role into HR.
And you mentioned a minute ago that the importance of having equity inclusion not be the sort of thing that sits off to the side, but that's embedded in all the work we do throughout departments, and I completely agree with that. I'm wondering how these two people will do that, though. I mean, it seems like we are then siloing off equity and inclusion into a department, namely HR. How do you envision those two folks will work with departments to make sure this isn't just something that it's a division within HR and that's it?
Sure. That's a great question, council member. It's similar to what we have in existence now. The equity and inclusion ecosystem that the city has includes the chief equity officer, the mayor's office. It also includes our 15 operating departments that we have. Each department has its own equity change team, is what we call it. And the change teams are comprised of department staff that help us to achieve the goals on our work plan. And so this change team meets on a quarterly basis. We go through trainings, we go through learnings. We also have what I call an equity core team. And right now that core team is comprised of two individuals, one in libraries and one in public works. And both of those departments have created a racial equity coordinator position to help lead the work in their department. So this ecosystem includes more than just those two staff positions. They will be in place to help lead the work, provide support as needed. But the ecosystem in itself and the framework that the city has been in existence since before my time, 2014, and in the previous administration. So these two individuals will help provide the support, help lead, help coordinate, facilitate, help provide consulting services, so to speak, to departments, but can't be solely responsible for the work of the city. The other thing that I want to state is that when I was put into this position, appointed to, into this position, what now, 4 years ago, it was a big scope of work. I was thinking about, oh, am I going to do external? What am I going to do for our residents in alleviating and getting rid of any inequities or disparities in the city? How am I going to help city staff? And what I found is that I can't do that. This one position can't be responsible for all of that work. So what I've come to in this space is that in order to be for our work to embed equity into the work of the city to where our residents feel it, I got to be laser focused on internal. And what I mean by that is our employees. Building up our workforce to see, view their work through that equity lens is going to benefit our residents. We have departments such as the Office of Financial Empowerment. We have the Office of Neighborhood Services. We have our Human Rights Department that has that outward focus scope of work that's on that is driving and embedding equity for our residents. They got it, and they're a great partner. But for our city employees, I got to stay focused on our employees' work. And so the partnership between those departments and this equity division is going to be key to ensure that those issues that our residents are facing day in and day out are brought to the table. But more importantly, for our staff to know, here are those issues. We need to make sure that we're armed with the resources and the lens to be able to work with our community and embed equity into the work that we're doing. Does that make sense?
Yeah, thank you.
Yeah, and the last thing I'll say is just, you know, I inherited the ecosystem from the previous administration, which was nice, which is good. We've been able to build on that, and having a division in equity of equity in HR, not gonna be siloed, it's just a way to sustain the work, but continuing the ecosystem that we've created and even broadening it beyond what we've done thus far is gonna be really key. So my goal is to have racial equity coordinators expand this core team beyond the two individuals that I mentioned before, to have one in parks, to have one in police and fire, the largest departments, to make sure that we, again, are institutionalizing this work and continuing to embed it. So I see this beyond the two people, even beyond the 15 departments and the change teams, but having some other core positions throughout the year. But as you know, that takes money. And it takes planning for that. And I've talked to those department directors, they're on board, but it's gonna take probably a few years before we get to that place. But I appreciate the question on that. And as you can see, I'm excited about it, the opportunity to do that. Learning and development, I've given you some insight of what we've done, and it gets to your question here. I knew I had something in here about supervisor. We've launched supervisor development series. Work. Again, we recognize that there's a gap, and we can provide as a follow-up to this meeting information about what we're doing for that executive series, but we definitely recognize that it's a gap. We have to provide training at all levels, especially if we're going to keep people. It's a retention strategy. If everybody, all of our, you know, frontline staff and employees are great, we've attended this training, we know what to do, and our managers are off, that's going to be an easy way for folks to leave the city or not join our workforce. So it's important for us to invest in that. I've talked about the training sessions we provided. We are working on a learning management system, and this is something that we're working with with OTC on as well. This is important because, to your point, when you ask me, council member, like, what's the list of trainings that we have? Where am I at on the track? My response to me, like, I don't know, right? We have all these trainings that you could sign up for, but I don't know where you are in your growth, right? The learning management system is going to help with that. I won't spend a lot of time with the other city, but as you all know, I used to work for the other city across the river, and the learning management system that they have had at the time and that they have now was amazing. I could go in and see, here's the five required trainings that I need, and I need them by this date. And I would get a ping saying, you need to sign up for your training, right? And I would know, be able to show my supervisor, hey, look at all the trainings that I received. Here's how I grow. I actually, before I left the city of Minneapolis and before coming over here, I completed basically their version of a supervisor's academy, a leadership U. And it helped put foundation into my leadership philosophy and how I am as a manager. So we have to get there. It's truly important for us to have a system. So there's the work, the planning of doing the training, and then there's a system to support that. So that is something that we're working on as well. We also know that people, you know, folks who are working remotely or just, you know, have different types of work schedule, they may not want to come to a training. They don't want to hear me talk or Abby talk or anybody else. They want to do their own. And so we are also setting up, you know, making available on our website self-paced training where you can do these things on your own time. And still, but we need the learning management system to be able to track that and show their growth. And then getting to a place of, we can't hire consultants all the time for this work. So how do we train the trainer? But there's a skill to that, and there's curriculum that needs to be built around that. And our deputy director is working towards that as well.
Two quick questions, Director, before we move on. One is just please, I guess one is a request. Let us know about the supervisor development and executive coaching, because we are all supervisors, and at least speaking for myself, I would really appreciate access to those learning opportunities. In terms of the learning management system, I think that's a really interesting and great idea. And I wonder if the plan is to connect those trainings then to promotional opportunities within the city, because we're talking about retention and talking about the difficulty of hiring. It does seem like investing in our own and helping them advance further within the city makes sense. And to have the trainings not just be, you can add this to your portfolio of trainings, but Sure. Take these three trainings and that's what qualifies you for the next step up in your department, for example, would help both with the retention and the learning.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, absolutely. And just to kind of zoom out a bit, I talked about INFOR and TAS. Maybe we'll put TAS on the side, but let's talk about INFOR, the upgrades there. That's so important because the system that we have now, we can't pull certain data. We don't track employees and their growth and promotions in the way that we should. And in the way that, and there's some limitations on the system in itself. So the idea is with this upgrade, and you may hear people talk about global HR, is INFOR, an upgrade to INFOR. INFOR has a learning management system that we can use, so we want everything to talk. We've had a history of, we're gonna buy this shiny coin that doesn't talk to this shiny coin, and then we're all using these, you know, coins that are no longer shiny anymore because they don't talk. So INFOR, this upgrade with INFOR is going to be really important because there's a learning management system. There's even an applicant tracking system that we're exploring whether we're going to use. So then everything is connected. So when you talk about the promotion and growth, we won't have to go and see if Ryan is on in this system, what Ryan is doing from a training standpoint, and then look at what's happening with Ryan and INFOR. All of the things will be connected, and we can see that growth, and we can build out the other piece of this is performance management system. It also has that capability. So our goal is to have something, a system in place, and a tool in place, so to speak, that is all connected, and that we can start to build out a strategic plan and a framework to track employees in that way. So it's a great question, and there's a method to the madness. It's not just like, let's do another upgrade. It's let's have everything talk, and then let's make sure that our employees have access to it, and we can build out a framework for them to grow and know how they're growing and can move throughout our workforce. So, okay, we talked about workforce strategy a bit around the recruitment, hiring, and retention. Here's our strategy, and we're kind of at the infant stages of building out the strategy. I want to spend some time with the mayor's office, the mayor and deputy mayor, and figuring out what do we do. I talked about the civil service rules and the systems piece. Our workforce strategy, unfortunately, again, we're not the private sector. I know some of us would like for us to be, but we're not. We're not the private sector. We're the public sector. So there's all sorts of rules, policies, and laws that put us into this, what I call a box, of what in establishing parameters of what we can do and what we can't. So our workforce strategy has to be maybe a little bit different than what some of our other employers would put together for their workforce. And I say, share all that to say, we have to start with the systemic work. I know you've heard me talk about civil service rules and how I'm excited about it. There's another opportunity where I'm going to talk about civil service rules and how I'm excited about it. We have to change our systems in order to create that flexibility. I oftentimes get asked, well, why can't we just go down to Arlington Rec Center and say and advertise that we're going to be hiring on the spot? I'm like, well, let's go through Civil Service Rules 7 and 8. What does it say about how we hire folks? It basically says you can't do that in the way that you're wanting to do it. And we want to get to the place to where we have the flexibility, we're nimble, and that given this labor market, that we can go out to Arlington Rec Center and advertise and have and try to hire on the spot. But right now, I can't do that in the way. And it's not because Tony doesn't want to. It's because there's a rule of policy that says that I can't. And then the unions have also said, well, our contract says you're going to follow the civil service rules. So this is what we're expecting. So this is the strategy one around work, our workforce strategy is to tackle out these systems, these roles. Minimum quals is one, and I know I've talked to some of you all about that. Our minimum quals may say, oh, you need a bachelor's degree, or you need a high school degree, or a driver's license, or whatever it may be. We need to modernize that. We need to figure out, like, are these roles and ensure, are these qualifications necessary for the job? So we're doing some work around that. I've talked about the redesign work. That redesign work is about having the right support in HR and the structure in HR and our departments to ensure that we have timely hiring processes, we have timely and effective onboarding processes, and also the resources to support our employees when they're interested in being promoted. And then recruitment engagement. One of the things that the mayor has stressed to me is that he wants to hire more residents of into the St. Paul workforce, into the city. So right now, roughly a third of our workforce are St. Paul residents. And I've asked the mayor, how do you want me to do that, given this labor market? And we're working through what the strategy is, but what I've conveyed to him, and I'm conveying to you all, we have to tackle the systemic work, the systems work that's in place, so that we can bring people in and they can be excited about it. They can feel like we're adequately paying them, that they have competitive salaries, et cetera. So the system work is really important. We do need to invest some resources into how do we recruit. And beyond, like, let me go out and find, you know, increase our applicant pool by 100 people. Beyond that kind of traditional type of recruiting, it's more so about how do we engage and create relationships with our residents to talk about how great it is to work for the city and to talk about the pathways into the city. And we need to create those pathways into the city to support our residents. Our second strategy is a financial one. And, you know, hence why we're here. Wage increases, and that's coming out of negotiations. We're going to have to shift in a way, and I don't want to make Tara nervous, so I'm not going to be throwing out any numbers. I know John was like, Tony, don't say this during the presentation. But the wage increases and negotiations are important. We're going to have to increase our wages. We just have to. And so we're in the thicket of negotiation season now, and my team in labor relations is working out a strategy for that, and we're working with the mayor's office on that and OFS as well. But that is the obvious strategy around financial. Our compensation policy, Ryan Gruber is here as our class and comp manager and has outlined a strategy for us to think about our compensation policy, how people move throughout the city. So when you come in, you're at step two. Well, when do you get an increase in pay? It may be another 5 years, maybe even 10 years before you receive another increase. Where is that happening in any other situation, right? Is that like when I'm gonna wave my flag around, like come and work for the city and you're not gonna receive a significant raise for another 5 years? Absolutely not. So there's some work that we need to do in working with our labor team on how we look at our compensation policy. And then incentives. There have been other public sector jurisdictions that have offered hiring, I won't use the B word, bonuses, but have offered some sort of hiring incentive or retention incentive for their employees. We need to start thinking about that. But again, we have to have the funding to be able to do it. And then our last strategy, and we spent a lot of time talking about growth and development, people need to feel like they're being valued. They need to be recognized. They need to feel like they're growing here in the city and not just we're staying here for X number of years or just a placeholder until they get the real job. And so the way that we change people's perspective and change the productivity in their work is by growing our employees and creating those opportunities. And we've talked about that already. So the training and development, we've talked about how we engage our employees. We haven't talked about this, but internal and external pathways. Oftentimes we talk about let's create a pathway into the city and bring folks who teach people how to get their CDL or teach people how to work in street maintenance. But we don't really talk about the external or the internal pathways. What if somebody in HR, if Ryan wants to leave me and wants to work for Public Works, how does Ryan do that? What sort of pathway? Ryan may have a 20-year history and background in HR. How does Ryan get to the Public Works Department? And is that a possibility for him? So those are some opportunities for us to explore and build out, but we need those systems, right? We need the learning management system. We need the upgrade in Infor. We need the plan, of course, but the opportunity to transition our employees from where they're at, wherever they, which department they're in, over to the next department or within their own department. So here's our strategy. Again, we're working with the mayor's office on building this out. There's tons of things that need to be put into this that's gonna take in place. But I'll say again and emphasize the systems piece, the rules, the policies, the law. Well, maybe we don't have as much control over the laws, but the rules and the policies are really important for us to create that flexibility and be able to really do some things that are, I will use this word, dramatic, a dramatic change for in a positive way, not negative, and so that our residents and our employees, they can feel it, feel this change in the city and feel the hiring processes change, feel the movement and promotion opportunities have changed. We need for our employees to feel that in order for them to stay and want to stay working for the city.
Director Newborn, I really am glad that you're thinking so hard about this, and I appreciate you including this slide in the strategy in the presentation. I'm curious what we've learned from those who are leaving, and do we know who's leaving? Are we losing a particular racial demographic? Are we losing a particular age or gender or department? I'm wondering if there's anything that we can do to advise our workforce strategy based on the folks who are leaving. I know if you were to ask us around the table, probably we'd say the best people are leaving and we see them leave all the time. But
sure.
I am, you know, we don't get the full picture. And so I'm wondering if there are any trends that you're noticing in terms of retention that informs this.
Yeah, so we're tracking turnover data on a quarterly basis. So it's a snapshot into over the last 3 months. We didn't see a high turnover over this past quarter. It's about roughly our turnover rate is about 5%. When you look at from an industry standard in public sector industry, it's high turnover would be considered around 18%. We're at 5. If you do, we have done a breakdown between people of color and women of color. It's roughly between 1 to 2%, but again, for that quarter. So, you know, we need to be able, at the end of the year, our OTC will work on a annual turnover rate. And so that's something I could provide to you from last year, but we won't have the data for this year until probably February of 2023. You know, I can only speak from an anecdotal standpoint at this point. We're hearing people talk about they're stressed out, the city, you know, I could lift up my department and talking about human resources, but I could also say for public sector human resources, it's been really hard because we've had to say no a lot and say we can't or we don't have it or we don't have the money, right? But that's going beyond HR. That's a lot of our departments that are just really stretched. And I know there's a lot of talk about remote workforce, the people who were able to work remotely and folks who had to be, you know, in person in whatever capacity, the folks who were able to work remotely, their workload actually increased, or they were working more. And there's this like change in sort of that cutoff change of when like, hey, I'm gonna stop working, right? And that's led to, and that's not the only reasons, but that's just led to our workforce being stretched, being stressed, and they're saying, no, I need to be done with this. I need to take a break. I've known employees who have transitioned out who they're not going to another job. They're taking a sabbatical and kind of cleansing themselves of the past 2 years. And so that's anecdotally what we've heard. You know, we have folks who, you know, have left because of family issues, right? And needing some additional type of support, given how COVID has affected school systems and, you know, people's medical needs, all of those things. So, you know, I can speak from an anecdotal standpoint of why folks are leaving. I will also share that we do offer exit interviews. Not many people take us up on that, but you know, we are hearing some of the same sentiments that I just relayed to you. I will say that I would like to do a better job of capturing that information, and you know, either it's from an exit interview or some other process so that we know why folks are leaving. But anecdotally, what I'm hearing, me personally, what I'm hearing, and even what I'm hearing from staff, is that this kind of during COVID, post-COVID environment, people are just burnt out, and they need some level of change. And we could talk about, well, we need more money here, we need more support, we need more resources. All of that would help, but I think the culture has changed in a lot of in employment, and then for a lot of employers around this need to like just keep going. We're just going to keep working, and there hasn't been an opportunity, or no one has said, take a break. We actually need to reset and let's take a break. And I think there's some opportunity there for a culture change to happen.
Thanks. Mr. Ballinger.
I probably should have asked this early on, but how are we recruiting? What is our main, how does someone find out or decide I want to take this job with the city?
Great. Councilmember Ballinger, thank you so much for that question. I'll say, give you the pre-COVID answer and then what's happening post-COVID. Pre-COVID, we had one or two recruiters for the city that would post jobs either on various websites, Indeed, LinkedIn, and I don't know all the rest of them, but we'd have someone that's doing somewhat of passive recruiting. Where they're posting things, our jobs on the websites, they would work with the departments and say, let's build out a recruitment plan for you. Let's do, and I'm an attorney by trade, so do we need to post on the bar associations? Do we need to post on these national and statewide organizations for our jobs? So we'd have our recruiters in place working with departments, posting those positions on the various websites, et cetera. And then maybe even working with some of our community organizations to post the jobs and make sure that they know about the job. The other thing that we were doing pre-COVID was we would hold sessions called Elevate Sessions, and our recruiters would go out and talk to, and we would host these events at our libraries and rec centers and invite community members to come and learn about the hiring process, because that tends to be a lot of challenge with our with why people don't decide to apply for our jobs, is that it can be daunting. So we were going out to and hosting these events on a monthly basis, roughly, saying, okay, here's our hiring process, here are the jobs that we have open, and we would even help people sign up to receive job notifications or even help them sign up for, you know, apply for a job, depending on the type of job. So that's what we were doing pre-COVID. COVID happened, we had to stop. I think we may have done a few virtual Elevate sessions, but don't quote me on that. But we are now starting to, as things have started to open up a bit more, we're starting to do those Elevate sessions now. But right now, it's mostly kind of this passive form of recruiting. And I don't mean passive in a necessarily a negative way, but it is us going out and posting the jobs. more of a proactive form of recruiting would be similar to what I talked about. And what's on the slide here is this engagement strategy to recruitment. Going out, making sure that we have the relationships with our community members, working with community organizations on like, what, you know, who wants to work for the city? What would be beneficial to you for the city to do to ensure that you know about the job, you know how that your constituents have the information that is needed to be able to apply for the jobs. And even one thing that the mayor and I have talked about is having a person or a team of people who are able to do something, not like an executive recruiter, but somewhat similar to where an executive recruiter would go out and they would create a database of people that are looking for jobs. And then the city or the employer will hire them to say, okay, give me your database of people. Help me find folks to fill the job. We want some version of that, but that's not an executive recruiter, but is engaging with community members and is creating this sort of database of people to say, hey, I have a crew of people for this upcoming accounting job. Here are the people that should that are interested in it. Let's send out the notices to them and get them applying for the jobs. So hopefully I hope that answers your question.
Yes, it's very helpful.
Thanks.
Ms. Yang. Thank you. I'll ask my questions now so it doesn't get piled up at the very end. Just wanted to name overall too that like whenever I am in conversations or like thinking about HR, I feel like we always live in a society that teaches us, hey, like you should just stick in your job and you know this should be like the perfect job for you that you stay in for a really long time. And I always have to ground myself that that like we as people are always evolving and mm-hmm. that transitions are actually like super normal for mm-hmm. Us in the workforce and in any organization. And so like turnover is you know, to me, I feel like it's also healthy too. And so I wanted to just name that because I know that we have experienced a lot of turnover. And, you know, in thinking about the question that Councilmember Naker asked, I was wondering, like, how often do you think that we are, that we have employees who maybe want to move up into positions, but there isn't a lot of opportunity for them mm-hmm. to do that. So that's why they move. Yeah. To work for a different city or move to a different organization, for example. Does that come up a lot at all?
Yes, and Ryan probably could take days and days to tell you about all of the questions that we receive and how people come and some level of frustration about wanting more and wanting to do more, wanting other opportunities, but they may not be there. And most of the time they're not there. Our city as a whole is pretty lean, right? There's not, I think about, and Ryan and I have had conversations around, what about the people that don't want to be managers, right? Within our hierarchy, we have like, okay, you're going to work at this level, you're going to be an office assistant 1 through 4, and then you go to the office manager, and then you go to, you know, whatever the next position up. And all of those positions up are where you're managing a team of people. Some people don't want to manage folks. I go day in and day out about whether I want to manage, you know, do people management, right? Because it's hard. It's a lot of responsibility. Not to say that they don't want the responsibility, they just don't want to manage folks. So there's not a lot of positions to move up to where you're not managing people. And that's an opportunity for us. We have folks who come to us, and employees who come to us and say, I think, you know, this position and title was created 10 plus years ago, it has significantly changed. I'm doing the job of 3 people now because of technology changes, because of X number of things, right? Well, I feel like I deserve more money or I want more responsibility. I want someone in HR to look at, do a job study, to use the technical term. We get that a lot. And we are able, for the most part, to make some changes and recommendations and to modernize or update the job, but there's not a lot of opportunities for them to go way above where they're at. And that's some challenges that we have as a workforce, being as lean as we are. And I will even say, for my own department, I have to ask and check in with Ryan. I'm like, does anybody want to be the HR director? Like, to let me know so that we can put you on.
Director Newborn, that's the second time you've referenced this. I'm getting nervous. I'm just going
to
say
I know. I'm just saying. The mayor told me I had to, you know, work on having a succession plan. So, and whether I have a real timeline or not, who wants to be in that position? No one's raised their hand as of yet. But what else? If they don't want to be the HR director, where do they go without leaving the city? My managers, pretty much, if they don't want to be the HR director and maybe they don't want to work in any other department, they either stay in their role or they have to leave the city for that next opportunity that's not that director level position. So we definitely have some challenges there. And when I talk about creating more positions and jobs, we're talking about money, right? We're talking about increasing our FTEs. We're talking about creating those opportunities. And right now, we're pretty lean. Some departments have that, but most don't. Mm-hmm. And small departments like HR, OFS, and emergency management, right? Like those smaller departments, you're for sure lean, and there's not a lot of movement that could take place. Mm-hmm. But thank you for the question.
Yeah, it is. As director, do you feel like that's something we need to be taking a look at, like within all departments? Because I know that's something that we in the council are talking about too, like trying to figure out staff restructuring. Like, hey, is this a role that we should fill and it's vacant now, or what else should we do with it? And so, what are your thoughts about that?
Yeah, no, Councilmember Yang, that's a great question. It gets to the strategy 3 around internal and external pathways. And pathways may not be the best word to use, especially if you're talking about internal, but that internal movement across the organization. And that's something that we want to focus on. But it also ties to, you know, our minimum quals, our rules that say you need to have X degree and X number of experience to be able to do this other job, and maybe you don't. And so there's some work that we have to do systemically and rules-based and policy-based to make some of those changes so that our employees can move throughout. And so that's what I mean by that internal transition, internal pathways of giving people a pathway to move across departments and where you don't have to leave the city. And one of the things, having, you know, worked for both cities, you learn a lot. I talk to some of my colleagues in the private sector and they're like, oh my gosh, I have to do this. I'm like, really? Right? You know, I've done that in every day for 2 seconds and I move on to the next like big task that we have to do. And so all of our city workers are like that. We're all like generalists and specialists every day. And so we have some really good skills that we've learned in the job. We need to free up our rules and our policies so that person can take those really good skills that they've learned and holistic skills that they've learned and apply it to another department. But we need to make room for that. And that gets into the rules changing, the policy changes and all of that, minimum quals changes, all of that stuff. So it is a priority of ours, but that's what I mean about that internal pathways across the department.
That's awesome. I am very supportive of us really taking a look at this and working to make the changes that we need to really like modernize and just make sure that like we are able to bring in the type of workforce that we need for our city to really do well. And so I feel that we are so lucky to have you as director with the values that you have, Director Newborn. I feel more is possible for the city of St. Paul. So thank you for being a champion, especially for racial equity. Going back to the slide earlier, under the column, like, where incentives and compensation fell under, yes. Is your budget ask reflective of like more money to provide those incentives? Would you be able to unpack that a bit more?
Sure. Not really. What I will say is it'll come out through, in some shape or form, the negotiations process. And we're working really closely with the mayor and with OFS on what it is that we can offer. So my budget proposal to the mayor, you know, it talked about all of the things that we should ask for, right, and to do, and then we landed in a place of what we could do given the reality of all the market and our current situation related to the budget. I think the negotiation process is where we will be able to, well, hopefully, we'll be able to make some of those ask or strategize with our labor partners on those type of incentives. I mean, it doesn't, the city has the ability to offer those incentives. It's just gonna get into, can we afford to do so? And we want to test the water a bit with our labor partners on what that could potentially look like. So something we're interested in, not sure where the from the financial standpoint, where we'll land there. And I'm trying to get to the question that you asked. Yep, I think I answered it.
Yeah, you did. Yep. Thank you.
Okay, thanks.
And Ms. Yang, before we move on, I just want to say I really appreciate and echo your questions about the way to advance without necessarily advancing to manage people and the need for people in our generation to move around more and just not than just staying in the same position for, you know, 30 or 40 years. I think that really is a hard nut to crack. I have a lot of conversations with my colleagues and people my age about their desire to advance, but they don't want to manage people. And I also think that your point earlier, Director Newborn, about what people do want, which is that work-life balance, if we could crack this nut as a city of allowing people to advance not by going higher up the org chart, but perhaps by having that greater flexibility or having that greater balance. It's a salary increase if you keep the same salary but get more vacation time, right?
Yep. Mm-hmm.
Or more flexibility. So I think that that's really something interesting, and I appreciate you bringing it up, Ms. Yang. I'd love to hear more about our progress in that direction.
Oh, that's great. One of the things that we did over the summer, you know, a lot of public sector jurisdictions were doing this sort of rollout of return to the office, right? And the mayor and deputy mayor chose to do it a little bit differently. They relied on the department's directors to decide, what does that mean for your department? Because we all know that each one of our 15 operating departments could be its own business in itself. So how are you, you know, and other jurisdictions figured out how to do it, but I think the thought process was, let's individualize this a bit. And what came out of that is myself and our chief innovation officer, Matt Larson, and Miriam DeMello from our mayor's office, the deputy mayor asked us to, let's do some focus groups, let's do some surveys of our departments on what's working for you all, what sort of workforce support. So we're not gonna call it return to the office because everybody's, you know, in some shape or form is back to the office, right? And have established some sense of a normal routine and schedule. But what, given COVID, given everything that's happened over the last 2 years, what do we find out we actually need to support our workers? And not to get into like remote work versus in-person work, but that's a thing, that's an issue. Folks had concerns around that. There was some flexibility that I myself had that my colleagues in public works and water and parks didn't have. And I know I'm the director and all of that, but still there's some flexibility that I had that others who had to be in person didn't. So we spent some time talking with our departments about what is it that you would that you need that would better support your employees and staff. And we're working with the mayor and deputy mayor of combing through those responses. And they weren't in the form of a survey, but it was more so like a focus group. Combing through those responses and coming up with what can the city do to provide some level of flexibility. And everything from like parking to childcare to, you know, flexible schedules, you know, we get into a kind of shift differential. Well, what if we work with the unions on waiving that or vacation time? You know, arguably, I may, as a person that has some level of flexibility about whether I'm in the office or not, I may not need as much vacation time because I'm at home, right? Or have a hybrid work schedule where someone that is in person a majority of their time may need a little bit more vacation time because they're in person, they're more subjected to all of the elements or their stress, right? All of those things. So we're looking into that and exploring ways that some of those topics and concerns can come into our negotiation process for our employees.
I know you have one slide left and it's the budget slide, so we should probably get to it.
Yes. Well, this is like a boring slide, I think. It just says how much.
It's only our job.
It's only your job, right? This is the boring slide. So we came up in working with the mayor's office. Our strategy was like, we're super lean, right? So when you talk about let's cut something from HR, that's like a person, right? And we've talked this whole presentation, if I haven't conveyed that we shouldn't lose any people in HR, right? We can't afford to do that given the demand. So what we did have at the point in time where we were going through the budget process, we had some vacancies in HR. So our strategy was to reduce, when we fill those vacancies, to reduce them at a lower level. So for instance, instead of hiring an HR consultant two, we're gonna hire an HR admin coordinator, and we're in the process of doing that. Instead of hiring a admin assistant, we're gonna hire a management assistant three. So there's some cost savings there. We reduced our materials and supplies budget. We reduced our contracted services, and that has led us to a budget cut of $55,000. So one thing that I didn't put, well, it's on here, it's on the slide. The mayor did, in his proposal, did offer to give us a payroll specialist. So we are receiving an additional staff person. And given there's been a lot of demand around in payroll with salaries, the changes that took place with negotiations this past year, lots of things have been happening in that on my team. So having an additional payroll specialist is gonna be really helpful. And payroll, although they turn the wheel of making sure that we all get paid, they also are a part of our onboarding as well. So when you start at the city, it's the payroll department that is gonna collect your documents, put them into the system and set you up and ensure that you get computer access and working with OTC. So having seeing the increase in demand of the number of hirings that we're doing and employees, having a payroll specialist is gonna be really helpful to relieve some of the work that they've been dealing with this past really 2 years. So see, this is the boring slide. Excited that we're receiving, hopefully we'll be receiving a payroll specialist, but the cuts we will be able to sustain. It's important to me that we are not cutting people, but cutting the types of positions that we're filling.
So just to be clear, it's a $109,310 increase over last year's budget, and is that entirely for the payroll specialist?
Say that again, Councilmember.
It looks like the change from prior year on your boring budget slide is $109,310 for 2023 compared to 22, and I'm just wondering, is that fully the new payroll specialist, or what else constitutes that increase?
Sure, I believe so, but I see Tara inching towards the mic. I will
nodding knowledgeably.
Councilmember Naker, as with all departments, you will see an increase in their spending related to salaries that are settled contracts. This is the net of those increases, less the reductions that Director Newborn just went through, and then plus the adding in the payroll specialist.
And Ms. Bernack, do you know what amount of that is the payroll specialist?
I think it's about 66 or 62,000. It's around 60,000, 70,000. I can get to the exact number.
And the rest are those inflationary increases in salary and benefits that get negotiated?
Councilmember Naker, that's correct.
Okay.
So that's it. We spent a lot of time together today. But really excited. I appreciate the opportunity to talk with you all about our strategic plan and the work that we're doing. And I really think that it's important work. And we oftentimes, where I struggle in being in HR is, like, usually people don't want to see us because they're like, they're gonna tell me no, or they're gonna tell me we can't, or we don't have enough money. And we oftentimes, we don't get an opportunity to talk about, like, hey, there's a method to the madness. We have a strategy around this. We want better than what we currently have. We really do. Unfortunately, but unfortunately, it's gonna take us time to get there. But we have a 41-person team that's really excited and energized to get us there. It's just gonna take some time. So we wanna get out of this, like, the no department, or the department that we don't wanna talk to or partner with, to the department, the first department that we want to get to know and partner with, because we're going to help you achieve the results that you want and the outcomes that you want. So I appreciate the opportunity to talk about the work we're doing and the direction that we're going into. And as always, if there's, I know there's a few things that you had questions about, we're happy to follow up with you all to provide that information.
Thanks so much, Director Newborn. Are there any closing questions? I know the last slide said questions, which we always laugh at because we sort of don't wait till the last slide, but any closing questions or comments, Ms. Yang?
Thanks. I wanted to express gratitude to you, Director Newborn, and to really all of our HR staff for the incredible work you all do during the pandemic. I got a chance to join the roundtables with our employees of color, and the topic at the time was about anti-Asian sentiment, and it was a space where people could come together and heal and unpack that so that, when they're on the job, they're not worrying about these things so much, and they felt like they were also in a safe environment where they can talk about this, where they were being heard, and where they mattered. And I also want to say that along with that, like I know many of our employees of color especially come to the workplace carrying so much. They carry a lot of trauma from really triggering events that take place in our community, like police brutality, and just like a lot of family trauma too, and that really linked to mental health. And so I really appreciate all that you are doing to invest in our employees, to make sure that they feel they're in a dignified workplace, because that really translates into them also being great workers and making sure that our residents here in St. Paul are cared for. And so I want to say continue doing that, and doing everything that you are doing. You're doing a really phenomenal job, and I just want to encourage us to continue doing all the stuff, like the trainings too. Like that is really, really wonderful for people to be able to make that additional investment in themselves, so that it can positively impact them in the workplace and also in their personal lives too. So I'm celebrating a lot of the work happening in HR.
Councilmember Yang, thank you so much. We will join you in celebrating as well. Thank you.
Thanks. Other comments? Ms. Jalali.
Yeah, I guess to add into that, I was thinking, just listening to a little presentation and thinking about all the different situations that, as council members, we're asked to listen to, like our budget hearing where we had workers come and talk about their experiences at work and very serious things they're navigating, and being in the city all day, every day, watching our constituents go through the same things as us, trying to get response. Like, there's just so much work that happens here. And I was really just struck with the thought, as you were describing your efforts and your role in that, like, this is an area of our city that it just feels highly personal to people. Like, working in HR can feel, or it can, the stereotype can sometimes be like, oh, this is just manuals and sort of like depersonalized information and rules. But the work that you're entrusted with is highly personal to people. It's about people's sense of fairness at work, whether they feel valued, the experience they have all day, every day, in a lot of the like mundane things that are what doing good work we do at the city is comprised of. So I want to thank you for just the level of depth and thought that you're bringing to that. I know there's a lot that you have to helm, and as we can see from the last boring slide, you don't necessarily get a lot of resources to do that, and we're in this with you to continue collaborating in partnership, and I wanted to just thank you for the thoughtfulness that you bring to this important area of our work. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Councilmember Jalali. One of my taglines for this year has been humanize HR, humanize human resources. And it's, not just for giggles, but it's an industry that we've lost the humanity into, and not being a human resources professional, coming in, as an attorney by trade, like, what is happening? Why aren't we smiling? And why doesn't anybody like us? And we've lost the, I think the industry in itself, but maybe in the city, we've lost the humanity into human resources. And my team is working to bring it back and institutionalize it, because we're supposed to be supporting our employees. So I appreciate your sentiments around that, and know that that is something, it is personal, and it's something we want to bring.
Thank you. Putting the H back in HR.
Yeah.
Well, with that, Ms. Newborn, just quickly to share some of my thoughts based on what you said today, I want to echo my colleagues' thanks to you. I appreciate the focus on training and learning, on equity and on innovation that you've talked about, and how to work smarter, not harder, and really maximize the amazing potential of the people who are already in the city and the people who live in the city at large, to bring them in to our workforce. Just going back to something you said about civil service rules, we kind of moved on from that, but I just want to note that, they weren't just for organized crime, obviously. They were also, I think, and as I talk to some of our employees now, I think the value that they put on our civil service rules that I share is that they protect the workers we have and keep us from that temptation to, when we bring in new workers, to treat them differently from the workers that we have and not give people the same opportunities. And so I think what I really appreciate about our civil service rules is that ability to treat people fairly, and I know you do too, and I think we can do both. I think we can treat our current employees with respect and help them advance and attract new employees. And so I just wanted to mention that in the conversation about civil service rules. And then finally, thanks for the heads up that wages are going to need to go up. Maybe not in this year's budget, but in future budgets, I think we recognize the need, and as Ms. Jalali said, heard it loud and clear from our from staff, that people need to be paid fairly. They need to be paid to recognize that inflation is is going up and eating into people's budgets, and at the same time, we need to keep our city budget in check. And so I think that's why we're constantly asking these questions about vacancies and reductions and working smarter, not harder, because as we pay people more, that's going to put pressures on our budget, but we need to do it. Yeah. So thank you again. And before we close the presentation, just a quick question to Ms. Houston for any follow-ups that she heard us say so that we're all on the same page about things that we might be asking for.
Council Vice Chair, or I haven't said this yet, Vice President Nager and council members, thank you. The items that I wrote down for direct follow-up, and please feel free to edit or add to my list once I'm complete, but is how many of the 197 FTEs have been vacant longer than a year? It'd be great to get a list of all the trainings that HR is offering. I believe there was 29 that I saw on the slide. And then please advise council members of any supervisory training. That was more just of a shout out. And then just clarification on the amount of the payroll specialist. And if there's any substantial data of who is leaving, why, and any trends on turnover, it'd be appreciated. But I think you really answered the question the best you could also here today.
Sure.
That's what I have.
Thanks, Ms. Houston. Thanks so much, Director Newborn.
Thank you. Y'all have a great day.
Thank you. Ms. Houston, anything in our last 2 minutes to let us know about for next week or other coming attractions?
Vice President Nager and council members, next week we will be hearing from the HERO department. And then we have a few more meetings left. So I believe we have the Office of Financial Services, a debt presentation, a five-year street plan, River Center and Visitors Authority, as well as OTC to round it out through November.
Great.
Thank you.
Thanks so much. There's nothing else to come before.